Hello students, welcome to lecture 2 in last of chemical equilibrium. In last class we started with the concept of reversible and irreversible reaction, chemical equilibrium, properties of chemical equilibrium and the law of mass action we have completed. And we come across a new constant called as equilibrium constant, which is the ratio of active mass or molar concentration of the product to the molar concentration of reactant ratio to their stoichiometric coefficient. We have completed that. Now we'll go ahead and we'll try to understand how to write the expression for this equilibrium constant. If we take the reaction nitrogen and hydrogen reversibly gives ammonia, we can balance this reaction by writing 1 mole of nitrogen, 3 mole of hydrogen and 2 moles of ammonia are formed. All they are in gas state. How to write the Kc, equilibrium constant, in terms of concentration is the ratio. Ratio of what? Molar concentration of product to the molar concentration of the reactant raised to their stoichiometric coefficient. Stoichiometric coefficient of ammonia is 2. So I write 2 here. Stoichiometric coefficient of nitrogen is 1. No need to write 1. Stoichiometric coefficient of hydrogen is 3. I write 3 here. Like this. We can express this in terms of pressure. Kp is equal to pressure of ammonia, pressure of nitrogen, pressure of hydrogen. And as ammonia has 2 moles, partial pressure of ammonia square, 1 mole, no need to write 1. Hydrogen 3, so it is cube of it. So in this way, by looking into reaction, we can write the equilibrium constant in terms of concentration and equilibrium constant in terms of pressure. But what is the relation between this Kc and Kp? This very important part, and we need to understand that. But before that, we must know what we mean by delta N G. Delta is the difference, N is the number of moles and G is the gaseous phase. So we can say it's nothing but sum of stoichiometric coefficient of gaseous product, only gaseous product. And from that we have to subtract sum of stoichiometric coefficient of gaseous reactant. We'll apply this to this particular reaction. We can say delta Hg is equal to sum of stoichiometric coefficient of gaseous product is 2. And from that we have to subtract sum of stoichiometric coefficient of gaseous reactant. Hydrogen is 1 stoichiometric coefficient and that of hydrogen is 3. That's why we can say 2 minus 4, that becomes equals to negative. If I write reaction here like 2HI in gaseous state and it gives H2 in gaseous state and I2 in gaseous state, what will be the delta Hg here? Delta Hg equals to sum of stoichiometric coefficient of gaseous product, this is gaseous product, this is gaseous product, 1 plus 1, 2. Minus sum of stoichiometric coefficient of gaseous reactant, that is also 2. So that equals to 0. Consider this reaction. Nitrogen, dinitrogen, tetroxide in gaseous state. Reversibly gives 2 moles of nitrogen dioxide in gaseous state. What will be the delta Hg for this reaction? sum of stoichiometric coefficient of gaseous product, which is 2 here, sum of stoichiometric coefficient of gaseous reactant, which is 1 here, and that equals to 1. So this delta Ng is nothing but sum of stoichiometric coefficient of only gaseous product. If one of the product is solid or liquid, we will leave that. Minus sum of stoichiometric coefficient of gaseous reactant. So this is the delta Ng. And now we try to establish relation between Kp and Kc. Very important relation. Try to understand it so many times. It has been asked in theory examination, in MCQs also. This equation is useful. So we are deriving here relation between Kp and Kc. For that, we will take one hypothetical reaction. X moles of A inversely used, Y moles of B. We can write Kc equals to, it is a ratio of molar concentration of product B raised to its stoichiometric coefficient divided by molar concentration of reactant A raised to its stoichiometric coefficient. For Kp, we can write partial pressure of B raised to Y, partial pressure of A raised to X. We know how to write this equation, just now I have explained you. It is a ratio, molar concentration of product, its stoichiometric coefficient. Molar concentration of reactant, its stoichiometric coefficient. Now we have learned in states of matter, PV is equal to nRT, P is equal to N by V, RT is number of moles per unit volume, which is nothing but concentration, molar concentration. So you can say P equals to this molar concentration RT, PA equals to, we can say PA equals to this molar concentration of A, RT, and PB equals to molar concentration of B, RT. We will substitute the value of PA and PB in this equation. And what we get now is, try to understand this. Very simple derivation, but if you do not understand, then final result is difficult to remember always. So try to understand how we are solving this. So Kp equals to Pb is nothing but molar concentration of BRT raised to Y, and Pa is nothing but molar concentration of ART raised to X. We can write this as B raised to Y, RT raised to Y. We have just splitted these terms. A raised to X and RT raised to X. For this, B raised to Y and A raised to X. B raised to Y divided by A raised to X. For this, we can write Kc, Kc. And for this remaining part, we can write RT raised to Y minus X. We can rewrite this equation as Kp is equal to Kc, RT, this Y minus X. Y is the number of moles of gaseous product. X is the number of moles of gaseous reactant. And that's why we can say it is nothing but delta H. So this is the relation between the Kp and Kc. Kp equal to Kc, RT raised to delta H. R is nothing but universal gas constant, and T is nothing but absolute temperature. Delta H is nothing but moles of gaseous product minus moles of gaseous reactant. Kc is nothing but equilibrium constant in terms of concentration, and Kp is nothing but equilibrium constant in terms of partial pressure. So very important relation between Kp and Kc. Kp equals to Kc into RT raised to delta H. You can write these 3-4 steps, they are not at all difficult. Equation has been asked to derive the relation between Kp and Kc. You can write these 3-4 steps easily. Now we'll have different conditions here and we'll try to compare values of KPI and KC. For example, if delta mg equals to 0, example for this is 2HR in gaseous state, we must reduce H2 in gaseous state and I2 in gaseous state. This is the example for delta mg is equal to 0, because 1 plus 1 is 2, 2 minus 1 is 0. We can say KP equal to KC. If it is equal to 0, it means RT raised to 0, any number raised to 0 is 1, and that's why KP equals to KC. If delta NG is greater than 0, the example is dinitrogen tetroxide, reversible use 2 moles of nitrogen dioxide. Delta NG is equal to 2 minus 1 equals to 1, so it is greater than 0. We can say that KP is greater than KC. Why it is so? If it is positive, then KP equals to KC multiplied by RT raised to any positive number. That's why KP is relatively greater than the KC. If this delta NG is less than 0, the example is nitrogen in gaseous state. You need not to remember all these examples. 3H2 in gaseous state, and we get 2NH3 in gaseous state, and delta NG equals to 2 minus 4, that equals to minus 2. We can say that KP is less than KC in that case, because here it is negative. It is negative means it is divided by. Divided by means KC is equal to KP multiplied by RT raised to delta NG. So KC is greater than KP. Delta NG is less than 0. So this is the 3 various conditions here. One example for each case. In every example, you should be able to find out what is the value of delta NG. Delta NG is nothing but we should see these physical states, gaseous states, only we have to consider. We have to see number of moles of gaseous product, and from that we have to subtract number of moles of gaseous reactant, and that gives us value of delta NG. So this is very important relation between the KPI and KC. Depending on that, KPI and KC. KP can be either equal to KC, or KP is greater than KC, or KC is greater than KP. So delta NG is the link between KPI and KC. So this is one of the again important property of KPI and KC. Now we have to learn about the characteristics of the equilibrium constant. This is also very important part included in our syllabus. Properties or characteristics of equilibrium constant. Characteristics of equilibrium constant. Now, what are the properties of the equilibrium constant? So there are some 5-6 properties. We'll try to simplify it. All these properties regarding values of equilibrium constant. And we'll make this small table here. Independent of means they does not depend, and depends on. So we can say first property, value of equilibrium constant independent of initial concentration. Why? Because value of equilibrium constant depends on equilibrium concentration. Equilibrium concentration is nothing but concentration present at equilibrium. It does not depend on what are the concentration present at the start of reaction. So it is independent of initial concentration. It is independent of catalyst. We know that catalyst cannot disturb the equilibrium. And it is independent of inert material added at equilibrium, because inert means that which does not react. So it does not depend on inert material added at equilibrium. It does not depend on catalyst. It does not depend on initial concentration. It depends on temperature. Now, how it depends on temperature? If it is endothermic reaction, and if it is exothermic reaction, its dependence on temperature is different. If it is endothermic reaction, as temperature increases, equilibrium constant also increases, because endo means heat is required. We are giving heat, reaction is proceeding in forward direction. If it is exothermic reaction and we are increasing temperature, effect will be opposite to what is expected. That's why equilibrium constant will decrease, because the reaction is exothermic, releases heat, and we are giving to it. So equilibrium constant will be decreased. Endo means enter, therm means heat. Heat is required, absorb. We are increasing temperature, equilibrium constant will increase. We have an equation, of course, it's not in syllabus, but we can remember this. Log K2 by K1 equals to delta H, which is again thermodynamic term, 2.303 R. T2 minus T1 divided by T1 into T. This is the equation. If we know two temperatures and one equilibrium constant, other can be calculated, because 2.03 is constant. R is universal gas constant, that means its value is known to us. And delta H is also nothing but enthalpy change, whose value will be given in equation. So this equation leads us to the value of equilibrium constant. So it depends only on temperature, and it can be increased by increasing temperature, or it can be decreased by increasing temperature, depending on which type of reaction we are talking about. And it is independent of initial concentration, catalyst, and inert material added. Now this is four properties we can say, and four we can say. Unit depends on reaction. The unit is not fixed for it. For example, the unit of Kc is equal to mole per liter raised to delta H, and unit of Kc equals to atm, which is unit of pressure, raised to delta H. So this delta N depends on reaction, that's why its unit is not fixed now. It depends on that particular reaction. So these are the five characteristics of the equilibrium constant. Its value does not depend on initial concentration. Its value does not depend on catalyst. Its value does not depend on inert material added at equilibrium. Its value depends on temperature. Increase in temperature may increase equilibrium constant or may decrease equilibrium constant. And unit depends on that particular reaction. So these are some four or five very important characteristics of the equilibrium constant. So first we have defined equilibrium, then we have defined equilibrium constant, then we have seen how to write it, two equilibrium constant, Kp and Kc. We have established the relation between Kp and Kc. Now we are learning the characteristics of Kp and Kc. Now, One more important part we can add into this discussion is regarding the effect of stoichiometric coefficient on the equilibrium constant. Effect of stoichiometric coefficient on the equilibrium constant. Because many questions on this concept has been asked in MCQs. So effect of stoichiometric coefficient on equilibrium constant. For that, we have to make one table, and through that table we'll try to understand effect. We'll say a reaction and the equilibrium constant. These type of two columns we'll make. If reaction is reverse means, if this is the reaction, A reversibly gives B, and its equilibrium constant is K, and if it is reverse, B gives A, its equilibrium constant is K dash. What is the relation between this K dash and K? So you can write K equals to molar concentration of B divided by molar concentration of A, product by reactant. And this new equilibrium constant is equal to molar concentration of A, product here, divided by B. If we compare these two, we can say that this new equilibrium constant is the reciprocal of old equilibrium constant, isn't it? So because it is B divided by A, it is A divided by B. So it is the inverse of the previous equilibrium constant. So if it is reverse, equilibrium constant is inverse. We can say that if reaction is reversible, the equilibrium constant is inverse. Isn't it? You are understanding this by this example. A gives B, K equals to B by A. B gives A, K dash equals to A by B. Compare these two and we can say that a new equilibrium constant is nothing but inverse of old equilibrium constant. If reaction is multiplied by n factor. So we can inverse means we can write 1 by k. If it is multiplied by n factor, how we can get the new equilibrium constant? For example, this reaction we have 2a goes to b. We have new equilibrium constant. How these two are related? We can say K equals to molar concentration of B by molar concentration of A. That's how we define equilibrium constant. K dash equals to B square divided by A square. And this we can write as B molar concentration, A molar concentration, square of it. And this B by A is nothing but K. So it is K square. So you multiply by 2 means multiplied by N factor. The new equilibrium constant, K raised to N. Isn't it? Because multiplied by 2, K raised to 2. Multiplied by 3, K raised to 3. Multiplied by N, K raised to N. In that way, we can write this. So these are very important thing in calculation. Do practice of it, then you will understand. If it is multiplied, reactions are multiplied, how it affect the equilibrium constant? Let's see, A gives B, equilibrium constant is K1. B gives A, B gives C, equilibrium constant is K2. A gives C, equilibrium constant is K3, and equals to what? So, right here, multiply by
data only. Reactions are added.
Now, if we look at these two reactions, we will consider this as equation 1, equation 2, and this as equation 3. We can say equation 3 equals to equation 1 plus equation 2, isn't it? Why we say so? Because A gives B, B gives C. If we add, we will get A gives C. This product side reaction it cancel. So what will be the value of K3 then? This is K1, this is K2. K3 equals to what? So you can say K1 equals to B by A, K2 equals to C by B, and K3 equals to C by A. We can multiply this two and we will get this third, isn't it? So we can say K3 equals to K1 multiplied by K2. What is K1? B by A. And what is K2? C by B. This B we cancel and it becomes C by A. That is exactly the K3, C by A. So when it is added, if we have constant, if two are there, they have to be multiplied. If we have constant, has to be multiplied. And if it is subtracted, if reactions are subtracted, then inverse means it should be divided. Reverse is nothing but subtracted. If we do, what is the subtraction means B gives A, like that. So equivalent constant is divided. So it is subtracted, you can say K1 divided by K2. Means it is divided. We'll take practice of this, but try to understand this. That if we reverse the reaction, equilibrium constant get inverse. If we multiply reaction by factorial, equilibrium constant is old equilibrium constant raised to n, which factor we have multiplied. If it is added, equilibrium constants are multiplied. And if it is subtracted, they ought to be divided. In this way, we can remember these operations and values of that. We will solve a very simple question based on it and let's see whether you can understand this question by this table. So I will write here a question, you try to solve this without looking into my solution. I will also solve, but you take your own time first and then solve this. A gives, A reversible gives 2B plus C. The equilibrium constant K1 equals to 16. D reversible gives half C plus E, K2 equals to 9. Calculate K4 half A plus E reversible gives B plus D. So I will rough here this part. I hope already you have written this. So two equilibrium constants they have given, and they are asked for the third equilibrium constant from that. So I have to obtain this equation, this reaction, By using these two reactions, we'll write this as equation 1, this equation 2, and this equation 3. How will get third from these two equations? At equation 1, we have reactant side only A. And here we have half A. So we can say equation 3 is nothing but equation 1. It should be divided by 2 because here is only 1 mole of A and half mole of A. E is there, which is not here, but that will be cancelled by a certain operation. So first thing, only 1 mole of A here, half mole of A here. So equation 1 should be divided by 2. And plus, E is in the reactant here, and here E is in the product. So what we should do to equation 2? Reverse 2. Reverse equation, and then we will get the equation 3. Whether it is correct, we will try to understand this by operation. Equation 1 by 2 means half A reversibly gives, 2B by 2 means B, and half C. This is equation 1 divided by 2. 1 mole was there, I have made half. 2 was there, I made 1. 1 was there, I made half. Plus, reverse 2. So reverse means product becomes reactant, reactant becomes product. E plus half C reversibly gives D. When I add these two equations, this half C and half C, we can cancel because they are acting at opposite side. And we have half A plus E reversibly gives B plus D. Yes, exactly this is the equation we are looking for. Half A, half A. E, E reversibly gives, reversibly gives. B, B. D, D. So, what will happen to the equilibrium constant? We can say that K equals to what we should do to the equilibrium constant, if it is divided by 2, K raised to what is the n factor? 1 by 2 means 1 by n is nothing but 2 here, and reverse 2, reverse means it should be divided. This is K1 raised to half. Why we made half? Because we have divided by 2 means multiplied by 1 by 2. So K is 2 n factor, which is 1 by 2. Reverse the, so divided, it is K2. What is the K1 value? 16 raised to 1 by 2, and K2 value is 9. So it is 4 by 9. K equals to 4 by 9 will be our answer. We try to understand this question because many such questions will be asked in the examination. We'll take enough practice of that. But they have given these two equations and they have asked the equilibrium constant for this equation. We observed these two equations and our plan is to get this equation third from equation 1 and 2. How we have obtained? We have divided equation 1 by 2. That's why it becomes K1 raised to 1 by 2, because divided means multiplied by, divided by 2 means multiplied by 1 by 2, the same thing. So n value is 1 by 2, divided by 2 means multiplied by 1 by 2, that's why K1 raised to 1 by 2. Reverse means inverse, inverse means 1 by 9. So square root of 16 is 4 and this 9 as it is. This is the value of the equilibrium constant. So this is one important concept here. One more question directly has been asked in JEE examination. I will put before you and let's see how you
understand that question.
The question is nitrogen plus hydrogen reversibly gives 2NH3. KC equals to 10 raised to minus 2 liter square by mole square. Calculate Kp at 227 degrees Celsius. This is the question and you have 4 options of course. But here we have to rearrange this equation. We can say that Kp is equal to Kc RT raised to delta M minus 2 0821. What is temperature here? 227 plus 270 degree, because absolute temperature we need here, which is 500. And what is the delta NG value here? Which is 2 minus 4 minus 2. This is minus 2. So one of the options was Kp equals to 10 raised to minus 2 divided by 0.0821 multiplied by 500. This was one of the options there. No need to solve in detail. But the question I have given as such, and this was one of the options here. So you might have understood how we have rearranged this. So in this particular class, we have learned about the relation between Kp and Kc, the characteristic properties of equilibrium constant, how to write the expression for Kp and Kc, and what are the values of equilibrium constant if reaction is inverse multiplied by n factor, if the reactions are added or if the reactions are subtracted. We have done all these things and 2 questions also we have done. We will solve many more questions. Be ready with the calculator and read this theory part. Even though you see it, you might think that this topic is difficult, but you give it time, then only things will get simplified. Listen again and again, make your own notes, see the printed notes and textbook, and you'll understand this topic. So, thank you for watching this video.